our third session on day two of the Mind Summit 2015. More clicks than bricks, but can e-commerce really replace retail? This is the question we are asking. Now, ladies and gentlemen, e-retailing has grown at a mind-boggling pace of 35% compared to, of course, the brick-and-mortar model of just 20%. The ease of purchasing, the deep discounts offered, the variety, and many, many more factors are fueling the e-commerce growth story. However, what we're asking here today is, will it be able to beat the conventional physical retail model, or would retail spring back with new strategies and FDI? Will rural markets be its savior? Well, our session 11, more clicks than bricks, but can e-commerce really replace physical retail? We'll take up the exciting developments happening in e-space and future trends. For the panel discussion, it's my privilege to welcome to the stage Mr. Kunal Bhel, founder and CEO, Snapdeal. Mr. Sunil Kaushal, CEO, Standard Chartered Bank. Mr. Arvind Singhal, Chairman, Technopak. Mr. Rajat Vahi, Partner, Consumer and Retail, KPMG India. We have Mr. Kunal Bhel, Founder and CEO, Snapdeal. Mr. Sunil Kaushal, CEO, Standard Chartered Bank. Mr. Arvind Singhal, Chairman, Technopak, and Mr. Rajat Vahi, Partner, Consumer and Retail, KPMG India. A warm round of applause for all our esteemed panelists. And to take this session forward, we have Ms. Shweta Rajpal Kohli, Group Business Editor, NDTV.
The stupendous increase in e-commerce, the jaw-dropping valuations that some of the online startups are getting, and an almost explosion that we are seeing in the use of handheld devices as well as mobile apps. All these trends have clearly transformed the retail as well as technology landscape of India. Hello and welcome to this very, very special panel discussion on a trend that impacts each one of us. More clicks than bricks. Can e-commerce really replace traditional retail? And we've got someone who represents just about every aspect of this debate joining us. We've got Kunal Bhel, a CEO and founder of Snapdeal, also joining us. Mr. Sunil Kaushal, CEO of Standard Chartered Bank. Mr. Rajat Vahi, Partner, Consumer and Retail, KPMG India. And to the extreme right, we've got Mr. Arvind Singhal, Chairman of Technopak. We're essentially trying to understand in this session the growth of the e-commerce market. How real is it? Are we going to see a shakeout given the huge competition and undercutting? Can the logistics infrastructure really keep pace with the kind of explosion we are seeing in the online order book? Can the formats of e-tail and traditional retail really coexist? And of course, the larger question of regulation. Where do we go here on? Should we have the government interfering at all? Or should the government just let the e-commerce or the online market or the internet industry be? Let me start by actually asking Kunal Bhel, who's really seen this the growth of this business, who's taken advantage of the e-commerce market in a way that perhaps very few players have managed to do. Kunal, share with us your experience, share with us how vibrant is India's e-commerce market, and are players like Snapdeal really giving traditional retailers a run for their money?
Well, thanks for having me here. It's a pretty broad question, and I feel there are a lot of misconceptions about the impact of e-commerce also. Some people see it as a very good thing, some people see it as a bad thing. At a meta level, one thing is for sure, e-commerce is here to stay, as it has been in every other economy of the world. E-commerce has always been seen to grow and seen to create quite a lot of impact for any economy, for consumers, for businesses, for brands, for even retailers for that matter. But the world of business, whether it's e-commerce or anything else, is very Darwinian in nature. And companies that evolve and take benefit of new trends benefit, right, and grow and achieve great things, and companies that don't fall away. And that's happened in every industry of the world over and over again. Our goal has been very simple, that how can we create a technology platform that can enable creation of life-changing experiences for small and large businesses equally, But the small businesses need it a lot more than the large businesses because they don't have the capital to be on main streets or in the malls. So when we set out to build our business, most e-commerce players in the country were actually buying and selling inventory, right? And our goal was that, hey, that doesn't solve a real problem in this market. What is really going to solve a problem in this market is how do you aggregate the long tail of supply with the many, many millions of small businesses across the country and offer it up as offer it up to the demand that exists across the 5,000 towns and cities of India. Mm-hmm. So we are now at about over 100,000 businesses who sell on our platform.
Right.
And our goal is to take it to 1 million businesses over the next 3 years. Because at that point in time, I feel we would have successfully potentially moved the needle for India a little bit, right? As a company and potentially as an industry also. A lot of people, to your point, say that, hey, is it hurting retail? It's hurting a retailer as much as the neighboring retailer hurts that retailer.
Right.
We don't compete with any retailer. A lot of the large and small retailers of India actually sell on our platform. Because
you're an aggregator today. You're not. You don't see yourself as a competitor to the traditional retail format. Is that correct?
Yeah, because we don't have any product of our own, right?
Right.
So it's important for us to really see our business from that lens, that anyone who wants to sell, it could be the largest retailer of the country or the smallest small business working out of a home. 30% of the sellers on our platform are actually women.
Right.
And so we are quite agnostic that way. So I actually think it's about retailers need to take advantage of these platforms that have gotten created and not see them necessarily as competition.
It's an important point that that Kunal has raised, and I'd like to take that to Mr. Arvind Singhal. Do you think the lines are really blurring? Do you think even asking questions as to whether one format, the online format, for instance, is threatening the existing format, which is conventional store-based retail, are questions that shouldn't even be asked because at the end of the day, lines are getting blurred. So you have the traditional retailers selling online. You also have cases of online players getting into the traditional retail format. So it's really those lines that are now getting blurred, and it's an overall pie that we need to look at.
I agree with you fully, because like every kind of a very fundamental transformational change, e-business, e-economy is one of those transformations which are taking place across the world. The single biggest trend which these e-businesses are enabling is from the producer to the consumer directly. And wherever you can disintermediate, you can do so. So news dissemination, entertainment dissemination, books, we know that in any case in digital form,
right.
And now merchandise. In that context, whosoever is able to be more efficient in bringing the producer to the consumer, that is what the real change is all about. It's not about whether you are a small physical retailer, a large physical retailer, a wholesaler or a distributor. For far too long in our country, the debate has only focused on ownership, in fact, not even the format.
Sure. But as someone who really understands this market, who's been a consultant, who's actually done the numbers, do you still say that it's fair to say, okay, a large part of the shopping experience is moving from traditional to online? Are those numbers important to track? Is it important to find out those trends that you have a market where people were going to a mall to shop and now they prefer to go online and shop on one of their favorite sites?
Yeah, of course we track it almost all the time.
Right.
But then you have to be very careful. You cannot aggregate what is happening in Saket, Select City Walk with what is happening in Muzaffarnagar, which is not so far from here.
Right.
You cannot even aggregate what is happening, let's say, in Mumbai with what might be happening in Thane.
And why do you say that?
So it's very, very important to understand the customer who's living in south of Delhi, or most of Delhi, an affluent customer, is time poor, option rich. E-commerce is an enabler for them to save some time. They can go out and party more or do whatever is in their lives.
Right.
Person who is in Muzaffarnagar, availability is a big challenge.
Sure. So it helps both.
It helps everybody, but for different reasons altogether. Somebody who is very poor, and half of India or two-thirds is very poor. Their basic need basket is just fruit, vegetables, basic food, and basic clothing. They're not the customers as of now for e-commerce.
Sure.
They will continue to buy from the traditional outlets. So I think the debate many times gets blurred in terms of because we try to generalize some micro trend to a national trend. I personally feel, and we have given enough data out over the last 10 years, it is our projection that the mom and pop store absolute numbers in next 10 years will double from the current numbers, double.
Okay.
And the reason is very straightforward. It's not a zero-sum game when it comes to consumption in India. 8% real GDP growth rate, 4% inflation, giving 12% nominal growth rate.
Sure.
The current market of $530 billion of merchandise sending will actually increase to more than $1,200 billion over the next 8-10 years' time. Modern retail in whichever format, physical, digital, even if it takes up $200 billion of that, you're adding a delta of $700 billion.
No, but we'd like to talk about the differentiator in the digital and the physical, and that's the important bit. While you're saying the overall pie is going to boom, it will explode, will digital grow much faster, perhaps because it's more nascent and it's a new industry than the physical? That remains the key question.
Yeah, but from a low base.
Right.
So the percentages, yes.
Right.
But would India be transformed in the next 10 years because of we? Maybe Delhi would, maybe some parts of Mumbai would, or a few cities. But you can't aggregate. That was a limited point I was trying to make.
Sure.
It's exciting times, though.
Exciting times, and we will come to the larger issue of internet penetration, rural market perhaps driving online growth or not, and those are important questions we'll talk about. But Rajat Vahi, if you could also share some insights into the way we are seeing retail getting transformed in India. While Mr. Singhal shared that there are different reasons why people may go online, that we are far away from addressing the needs of someone, say, living in Muzaffarnagar, who has to just go ahead and buy traditional fruits, vegetables. But do you think we are moving in a direction with the kind of explosion we've seen in handheld devices, with the kind of adoption of technology we're seeing in India, where even that day is not too far away, where we'll be seeing basic fruits and vegetables shopping online happening across India, across rural markets?
I think fruits and vegetables is a bit of a stretch right now.
Okay.
People are going to try that. I think the big factor that drives e-commerce today is in India, the footprint of organized retail is very, very, very less. Back to what Arvind is talking about. Today, you don't have availability of products. Look at the categories that do well in e-commerce, electronics, apparel, books. How many bookstores do we have in India? How many apparel stores do we have in India? I mean, most of the biggest brands, they will have 100, 200 outlets. It's very hard for shoppers to reach product. Today, people buy on e-commerce because it's convenient, because there's access, they have an assortment available, and because they have very, very competitive price. So I think these are factors that drive retail everywhere, and I think that's what's sort of, in a way, driving a lot of the consumption on e-commerce, where there's availability, where the footprint of retail is not that broad, and that's enabling people to be able to go and buy. It's also a big factor, back to what Arvind was talking about and what Kunal mentioned, is the point that, you know, today, convenience is a big, big point for shoppers. They don't want to waste time trying to, you know, find a parking place, going to a mall, going through a lot of traffic. If I know the product I want to buy,
right,
why should I not buy it and get it home, get it delivered home?
Sure.
And sort of that links into another thing that we keep forgetting about, that there are about 70, 80 million people who are above 60 years old in India. I mean, the whole experience of going out shopping, getting into a car, driving to the nearby store, trying to park, go through a security in a mall, these are big obstacles to purchase. We have not made shopping easy in India for many, many years. And to that extent, e-commerce fills that gap by enabling people to get access very, very comfortably and at a very competitive price.
So are you seeing a shift happen, is the question I posed even to Mr. Arvind Singhal. He is saying it doesn't matter, you've got the overall pie growing. But are you seeing that clear shift happen, at least in certain markets?
Absolutely. I think there is some shift. The point today is that modern retail accounts for 12% of the total retail in India.
Right.
E-commerce today, depending on what numbers you believe, between 1 to 2%. So the pie is going to
grow. Would you believe that number, Kunal? 1 to 2%? Okay.
So e-commerce today is definitely maybe taking up some of the business from modern retail or organized retail, but organized retail needs to grow fast as well. And today, I think in India, we have a two-horse race. We have organized retail up against online retail, or offline and online. And I think it'll be interesting to see how organized retail now takes up the mantle and adapts. Because last 2 years, we've hardly seen any growth because of real estate issues and all the other challenges. And they need to be able to offer a better product to shoppers,
sure,
more service, data analytics. I think one of the biggest things Kunal will talk about is data. They
right.
sit with a lot of data, they mine the data, and all of these things help
sort of drive that?
We'll talk about data. Quick word from Mr. Sunil Kaushal, really, on the changes that technology is bringing about in the financial landscape. While it's obvious that that categories like apparel, books, music, travel have moved on very quickly to the online space, and there are inherent advantages, what about financial services? Will that be the key driver, the key big change we're going to see in India? And also important that we see that the financial industry is also collaborating with the online industry to make sure that they get the necessary advantage.
I think first of all, it's already happening. So if you look at our largest user of credit card is actually a wallet company, is a payment wallet company. So that's the biggest client, so as to say. Banking is a highly regulated industry. So some of the changes perhaps are being pulled back or restrained because of the regulatory overlay that you have.
Right.
But having said that, in the last, I would say, decade or so, or slightly less than a decade, the big change that's taken place is, in a bank earlier, the biggest investment was keeping the people aside, was on the real estate.
Right.
So the big fundamental question was, how much do you invest in real estate? Where do you expand? So on and so forth. That was bulk of your cost, so as to say, in terms of capital outlay, and perhaps a bit to support in terms of technology and other support functions. It's changed dramatically now. Today, the game is how much do you invest in technology and how much do you pull back from the real estate investment to substitute it. We don't think it's going to be either or. It's going to be complementary in many ways, just given the demographics. So you have a pipeline of millennials and the Gen Y coming in who have only seen the online channel or a digital channel, and they will migrate towards that. And they've already migrated.
Right.
They may even not use a bank in the distant future. But you're going to see what we call digital kind of thing. So you'll have digital as well physical kind of coming together. And so that's the big conundrum that we are facing. How much on digital? How much do you really use digital to make the lack of, say, a physical presence actually a competitive advantage so that you're able to deliver a lower cost proposition to the customer? So profound change is happening, but we have a regulatory overlay which will perhaps moderate it.
We'll talk about the regulatory overlay, especially for the banking industry, but more importantly, for the internet industry as well. Before we move on, Kunal, I'd like you to actually highlight some of the challenges being faced by the online industry right now. We know you come with inherent advantages, lower overhead costs, you can go ahead with lower markups, offer the kind of price discounting that a traditional format cannot. But at the same time, I'm sure there are challenges that you face, and I'd like you to particularly highlight some of those challenges that you face, which could even be very unique to the Indian industry.
Yeah, no business is without challenges. And the grass always seems greener on the other side.
Okay.
Right? I've seen that. The challenges in our space are evolving. Mm-hmm. 3 years ago, if you asked me the question, the challenge would have been very, very different. That's when we started. And the challenge then was people used to tell us, hey, will internet happen in India? Will there be enough broadband users? The point broadband was brought up very often in investor meetings. That when we would show projections, they would say, but there aren't even that many internet users in India projected to ever happen. But then mobile internet happened, smartphone prices fell. Now you can get an amazing smartphone for 5,000 rupees.
So those questions aren't asked anymore.
So that one is gone now. There's no one who would argue with someone saying that in 5 years from now we'll have 500 million internet users in India. I think most people would say yes, that'll happen. Then the next one that came was around logistics, right? So because there weren't many logistics companies that were serving e-commerce, there was probably Blue Dart and just one or two more. And so people said, hey, is there enough logistics capacity that exists in India to service the number of orders that you're projecting you will do?
But is that still a relevant question, or is that question being
addressed? I think that question is being relatively mitigated now.
Okay.
Because there are a lot of e-commerce specific logistics companies that have opened up who are building a lot of capacity.
Right.
So at least directionally, we are on the right path. There are enough entrepreneurs who've said, hey, that's a great market opportunity. The opportunity to build a platform is gone, but let me build an enabler now.
Right? Okay.
I think going forward, I feel the next big one is going to be, can companies innovate on technology and data analytics, right? That's going to be the next big one. So you're seeing that the complexity of the problems is increasing sequentially. And as a result, the Darwinian nature of our industry is becoming very acute, right? So fewer and fewer people are making it through subsequent funnels in our industry. 3 years ago, there were 900 e-commerce companies in India. There are like just a handful left now, because the complexity of problems are becoming quite acute now.
So you're saying a sort of shakeout has already happened?
Yeah, it's more or less happened, right?
Yeah.
We were one of 900 companies 3 years ago. So now at least people don't remember 900 companies.
But what's leading that to happen? Because on the contrary, you should actually see more disruption, more innovation. Mr. Singhal, if you could throw light on that, is that going to be the next phase, the next growth driver? Because as Kunal is saying that you've seen that the problems are getting more and more complex, and which is why what you need now is real disruption in this industry.
Yeah, I have a slightly different view, a bit more optimistic in that sense. I think while there is a first wave which happened as far as e-commerce is concerned in the last 3-4 years, and there were many who jumped into it with just an idea. Some
right.
were copycats. Some had an idea but could not execute it correctly. And therefore, from those 900, I don't know how many exist today. Nevertheless, the work which is being done, if I may use about pioneers,
right.
whether it is Flipkart, whether it is Snapdeal, whether it is Amazon, and many, many others, whether it is on the logistics side, the technology side, the warehousing side, the sourcing side, supply chain, you name it. All of that work is like a highway which is being put together where almost anybody can use. So I actually see a second wave of entrepreneurs emerging over the next 2 years who will not necessarily have to face all the challenges which the pioneers had to face.
Had to face, yes.
So while they may not all be competing on a universal marketplace platform like an Alibaba in the China or in India, Snapdeal or others, I think there is enough way to slice the market into sustainable, profitable niches. So I'm actually very optimistic that e-commerce, one of the biggest opportunity for India is one which Kunal mentioned about the manufacturers. For the first time in my memory at least, a manufacturer can find a customer without having to go through very expensive and very difficult distribution challenge.
Sure.
If you have an idea. And entrepreneurs who otherwise cannot get jobs, but they have an idea. A lot of them will succeed from this.
So actually, would it be correct to say that while we keep talking about the e-commerce market being more B2C and we're talking about the consumer, it's actually the explosion in B2B. Would you describe Snapdeal as B2B or B2C, Kunal?
Yeah, so actually, large majority of the merchants who sell on our platform,
right.
many of them didn't even exist.
Right.
So they became entrepreneurs to sell online, essentially. Right. And a large majority of the remaining are actually folks who were in this trading business, were doing mostly B2B, where they said, hey, now I can reach to consumers across the country. I'll give you an example. Surat has one of the largest sari markets, wholesale
sure.
markets. Most of them are selling wholesale to other people,
right?
Who are then taking it to selling it to another person. And after 4 hops, the product is 2x the price for the end consumer. The same Surat manufacturer of saris, if he was making the sari for 350 rupees and he was making 500 rupees earlier, he's making 600 rupees now, and
okay.
the consumer is getting it for 799 versus 1800 that they had to pay in a retail market.
So it's a win-win for everybody.
Win-win for those who are adding value to the supply chain.
Right.
But not for those who are just adding fact to the supply chain.
And is that what keeps this model going? Is that something which will make sure that the growth of e-commerce will in many ways outpace traditional retail?
See, inherently in any industry, there is always a flight to efficiency.
Right.
When there is symmetric knowledge available, symmetric information in the world, there's always a flight to efficiency because you can't hide behind anything, right? As there's more and more symmetry. What is our platform doing? It's essentially creating symmetry of information in the country for
right.
commerce. And to the earlier point you were making, we have to view e-commerce as also driving incremental GDP growth. Now there is a lady in Bhubaneswar who can buy that Surat manufacturer sari, which earlier she could not buy. And that commerce was not happening earlier. So
right.
that is purely incremental to our GDP now.
Right, so it's incremental, not necessarily taking one away from the other. I can't have a debate on e-commerce and not touch upon regulation. Perhaps I could get Rajat Vahi to first give his view on the rather shrill debate that we are seeing right now on net neutrality in India. Your thoughts on, and of course it's now acquired a political color, we know that there are very, very strong views, but your quick thoughts on the way this debate has gone on and where do we see it headed?
I mean, this is a very hot ongoing debate, so I'm not going to comment too much on it, other than to say that, my sense is that net neutrality is an important element, and I think it needs to be encouraged. I mean, I think that the debate may be taking slightly different turns in terms of the regulator getting involved and the papers that have been put out, but my sense is that it's a positive thing. We need to respect net neutrality. Back to what Kunal is saying, the platform needs to be available for everybody to play at a level playing field, so that the small entrepreneurs and small businesses can also come and access it without having to without favoring one over the other. Because we go back into the distribution system which we had in India, where only if the distributor liked your product would he keep it, otherwise you couldn't sell your product. Today, sure. Thanks to these platforms, I can get up tomorrow and get within 4 hours listed on their website and sell my product to an end consumer sitting in Kanyakumari. So that's what we need to do. And I think these platforms, the neutrality element helps with that.
Kunal Behl, I'd like your view on net neutrality. It's been a debate that has occupied tremendous mind space in India among the youth who feel very, very strongly about it. Your thoughts on some of the points that have been raised in the last few weeks?
I think there are a lot of points being raised,
right?
And sometimes it's hard to connect the dots between the different points also. But at a meta level, the way I see it very objectively, would today I be sitting with such esteemed panelists if there was no net neutrality in India? The answer is probably no.
So you support net neutrality?
We always supported net neutrality because how can we not, on one hand, we are building a net neutral platform for small businesses to sell.
Right.
On the other hand, how can we not support net neutrality at a macro level?
But do zero rating services, for instance, Airtel Zero, just to cite an example, actually violate the principle of net neutrality? That remains the larger debate.
It does, and for that you'll have to check with Airtel.
Okay, but you would not, Snapdeal will not be seen partnering or getting onto a zero rating platform ever. Is that something
Look, we haven't partnered with any such service. Also, I think the jury is kind of out on what do these services mean. Clearly, there is a viewpoint that some people have that they don't violate net neutrality. Some people say they do. We've kind of said, hey, we are for net neutrality. We exist because we grew up in a net neutral environment. And there is no reason for us to not be supportive of it for future innovations in the country, many of which may be competitive to us. But that's okay, because that's what makes us up our game also.
And while this debate is going on around the world, Kunal, we've also seen here now it's acquired a political color. Share with us whether you're actually happy to see the kind of support net neutrality has got in India, with the number of emails being sent to the telecom regulator, with politicians in fact jumping in, and the debate becoming extremely shrill at this point.
So, look, I'm a simple entrepreneur. I don't know much about politics, so I would leave the political aspect of the net neutrality debate to those who are experts in it.
Okay, but a quick word on the TRAI consultation paper, because we know Friday is the last day for receiving feedback. Many have actually gone ahead and said that the paper is very, very regressive. There are some who have said that it takes you back to the license regime. Your thoughts overall on the issues that have been raised by the telecom regulator in the paper and the impact it can have on the internet industry?
Look, I think there is a commercial constraint that telecom operators, service providers have, that they're spending so much money on spectrum, so much money on infrastructure, and then a lot of these services consume quite a lot of the resources, but they're not adequately compensating the telecom operator. That's their concern. It's a commercial concern.
Is it a valid concern?
You'll have to ask them that question.
But do you, as an internet player who's riding on their network, feel it's a valid concern? Would you be willing to part with your revenues to compensate them?
I think, every business has to figure out how do they make their business work.
Right.
And I have never built or intend to build a telecom company, so I'm no expert at figuring that one out. I think we have incredibly smart people running telecom companies in India. They should figure that out. What we know how to do is, hey, we have a platform which is accessible by everyone. at equal speeds as any other platform. Now, the differentiation we are going to build is by providing a great experience for buyers, for sellers, and focusing on that problem rather than focusing on problems which we don't control.
But does it worry you that you have a paper that calls the internet a dangerous place, a threat to privacy in today's times?
Look, at the 118 pages, oftentimes words are taken out of context. I also do recognize that I've gone through the paper in some detail, but I don't remember each word and the context in which it was used. At a meta level, I think any internet company should always view the net neutrality debate as, hey, why shouldn't we be for net neutrality? And that should be our position. And then leave the policy making to the others.
Okay, one quick message for policymakers that you have at this point, because you say you exist today because of net neutrality. Many online entrepreneurs also say they exist because there is absolutely no regulation or lack of it. What's your message today to policymakers who are in some ways looking at regulating the internet industry and bringing in new rules and regulations?
Look, I don't think the answers to any of this are that binary. Everyone always says, oh, because the government didn't touch the IT sector, hence it grew. There are always pockets of every industry which need to be regulated to keep everyone's conscience in check.
Okay.
Now, let's say things like payments. Payments are regulated for a reason, so that people's money is protected. Payments is a big part of e-commerce.
Right.
So I don't want to sound that, hey, regulators, please stay away, because that's not fair. Also, we're running in a civil society that has some rules and regulations
sure.
and laws. But outside of that, I think it's better that if we build a platform in a manner that it's accessible by everyone to sell and everyone to buy from. I don't know the extent of regulation that will make it better or make it worse. I don't think this is a space that requires that much regulation, the act of buying and selling online. I think that's a pretty simple task. The act of paying should be regulated. It is regulated. The RBI is an incredibly sophisticated regulator in India, and they have their eyes on this, which is good.
All right, I'd like to take this discussion forward slightly before we move on to other points, and I'll come to you on the payments and the regulatory aspect. But a quick word really on what's happening right now, because to the average layperson who's seeing this debate evolve, it seems it's clearly an all-out war between telecom companies and the internet industry. Is that healthy or unhealthy, Mr. Singhal, for the growth of the internet industry?
See, I would take a view that maybe it's a good time to have a debate like this.
Okay.
I think the jury is still out in terms of what is right. Kunal just said there are lots of issues where it's very difficult for anybody to connect all the dots and come out with the clarity. But if you don't have a debate, then you cannot find the right answer. So I'm optimistic that this debate is actually healthy rather than unhealthy. Leave aside the political aspect of it.
Sure.
I wish we have more debates. Of course, they should not be only debating.
Right.
There should be a time limit as to when the debate must end.
Right.
And clarity should prevail. In FDI in detail, I'll be talking about detail here.
Absolutely.
There is only the notion of a debate, but I've never been to a single platform like this in my 15 years on this topic, where a politician articulates with facts, actual data.
That FDI in multi-brand retail is not good.
FDI, right. That why it is good or bad.
Right.
So there's no debate. It's basically a political viewpoint.
Standpoint, right.
Which you are expressing through your policy papers or whatever else. So to that extent, I'm in support of this kind of a controversy which is going on. It is also engaging a lot of people who otherwise would not be engaged.
Sure.
So I think we are actually by default broadening the scope of the participants in this. I'm for it.
All right, it's an interesting viewpoint there coming from him that actually the debate on net neutrality is healthy because it's a good time, it's an evolving industry, it's a nascent industry, and it's an industry that requires us to ask some of those tough questions. I'd like you particularly, Mr. Kaushal, to focus now on something that Kunal raised, and which is really the overall financial regulatory space and how important that will be going forward. We've of course seen that there are some trends which are very unique to the Indian online industry. For instance, cash on delivery. Correct me if I'm wrong, Kunal, or maybe one of you, that's a model in the online space which is unique to India? In China, it's Mark, so okay, so it's happening more in the developing markets, but that's a model which has been developed particularly to take care of concerns that would be there to get more people onto the internet space. Share with us going forward, how important will it be for the financial industry to collaborate with the online industry, look at new various payment methods. So we're seeing, of course, payment gateways, we're seeing wallets. How is it going to evolve here on to make sure that the user experience is more and more friendly?
Let me just briefly comment on the net neutrality which you
sure,
raised
we'd love
and
your views.
The passionate
yeah.
discussion about it.
Right.
The good news is we are in great company. It's a raging debate in the US. It's a raging debate in Europe. And I agree with Arvind that it's better to have a debate than have none.
Absolutely.
Clearly, the issue there is that a highway has been created by some and usage is by others. And the problem occurs when there are competing services being provided by the one who's created the ecosystem and the ones who are using the ecosystem. That's when the debate comes up. So I think it's good to have the debate. It's going to be a huge playing ground for everyone. And it's better to get the rules sorted out after a healthy debate
but
and constructive debate.
Now that you raise it, would you agree with the view that if the highway is being created by someone, it's all right for them to charge a toll?
No, I don't. I'm not getting into that discussion at all.
Okay.
All that I'm saying is it's good to have the discussion
okay.
and sort out, because this is going to be the future going forward. Rather than brush it aside and take one view or the other, I think we are going to reach somewhere a middle path on this one. So we'll keep that on the side. Now, coming to the point in terms of e-commerce, banking and the payment ecosystem, listen, I think what's happening with digital and e-commerce is phenomenal for banks to start off with.
Right.
At least that's the starting point. Because you're bringing that into the organized sector.
Absolutely.
You're bringing it into the organized sector. Even this cash on delivery is, I think, the first stage of settling. It is also there in your mobile payments in the developing markets where people really don't use it for remittances that much. They use it more for... I'm talking remittance from their account, not
yes,
from a wallet.
Sure.
Because the trust factor is slightly low. Will it give access into my account? Will it get, hacked, so on and so forth? But that's the first stage. So if you see the developed markets, it's not that much of an issue. Even if you look at the US, an Amazon packet, you'll find it more often than not kept outside the door of the person who ordered it. It doesn't happen in Asia because, it'll quickly disappear. So this is the first stage, but we are very excited because it's going to bring more and more transactions from cash at some point in time into wallets and then into other forms of payment. So it's broadening and widening the pie for us. I think the regulators are experimenting with it because in many ways, the reason of regulating banks was how do you protect deposits, the retail deposits particularly.
Right.
That in many ways has now moved because of the wallet companies has actually moved out of banks and is sitting with companies that are not regulated by the Reserve Bank of India or any other regulator.
Is that good or bad?
This is not for me to comment on it, whether it's good or bad, but it has moved. So it has disintermediated to an extent. So the very licensing was to control or ensure that it sits with
And we see that
strong,
shift happening
yeah.
now.
So
right.
to start a bank, you require 500 crores as capital, but to start a payment wallet, you really don't require that kind of capital. So that's happened. And I think the regulators are looking at it. And that's where you see the first phase, which is the payment banks coming in play, which will be under the umbrella of the regulator. And I think in many ways it's an experiment because they realize that the whole ecosystem is changing. And you really, at some point in time, will have banks playing a big role in it, whether it's banks or hybrid, so on and so forth. So that's the right step forward. But they are also moderating and calibrating it
right.
with ticket sizes and the amount of money that can... And the payment banks cannot lend money, so on and so forth. They can only facilitate the payments part of it. So we are moving the right direction. We are at very, very early stages. We really, it's going to be hugely disruptive going forward. Already in the West, the smaller ticket payments and the smaller ticket loans are getting completely disintermediated and moving outside the banking system.
Sure.
So I think we're at a very early stage.
Okay, so we're at an early stage. We have a long way to go as far as adoption of that is concerned. I'd like to quickly move forward before I invite questions from the audience to also try and understand the kind of valuations we're seeing some fantastic companies, of course, like Snapdeal get. Do you think there is a case of a bubble that might burst? Do you think there are worries that the kind of funding they're receiving, the kind of the way the valuations have jumped, there is a bit of a worry there?
Again, you know, I think the in terms of what is the optimum valuation, it's very hard to comment on that. I mean, I guess the e-commerce companies are best bet. I think from my perspective today, this is a new channel. It's creating a lot of excitement. People are very excited to be part of it. If you just heard Kunal mention 100,000, you know, suppliers selling on their platform. So it is really touching a lot of people, and hence there's a lot of excitement with it. With any new sector that comes up like that, there is likely to be, and we've seen that in India before. We've seen that in other categories as well. That, you know, it tends to, of course, you know, there is a chance that the valuations, you know, people get excited about these industries. I think in the long term, if you're again in e-commerce, long term could be 1 or 2 years. I think you will see things level up. You will see maybe the level of discounts, etc., being offered also start to get more moderate, because the shoppers right now, they're trying to attract shoppers to build the channel. Okay. I think it's important to do that. Modern retail did that 5 years ago, does that today as well. Today you have big discount days run by Future Group and other retailers. Certain is why do they do that? To attract shoppers to their stores. I think same way this is happening. I think there will be a leveling out of it. And I think that what you're gonna start seeing is more and more regular business going through these channels, and they're becoming a part of a distribution channel for all brands and retailers.
Mr. Singhal, yeah, quick point for you.
Yeah, I think sometimes some of us who made the mistake of going to a B school 30 odd years ago only have got one way to figure out what is a valuation.
Right.
I think the way to see in context, there are two kinds of premium which I've been giving to companies like Snapdeal. One is the disruption premium for the entire ecosystem of retail, which is fascinating.
Sure.
And we can have a discussion for 1 hour in terms of what the potential of the disruption can be. And second is the disruptors premium. The people who have chosen to disrupt efficiently.
Okay.
So there are two layers of this premium, which is available to these companies, which cannot be measured by the normal metrics, which we are taught in these schools there. So I don't think it's a bubble. Yes, some disruptors could fall off the way, like Kunal just talked about. There are sequential increase in challenges. The day you fall, it's a high-risk game. You may have a zero value next day, but that doesn't matter. The industry will continue to enjoy the kind of a superlative premium because of the fascinating potential of the disruption which it can cause.
I think it's an important point you made, and I'd like Kunal to actually respond to that. Disruption is something that has actually transformed this industry, and the fact that, you know, there are disruptions and there are disruptors. How long will we see this trend continue? Do you think we'll just see this sort of phase now get over? And of course, there have been some who've even have had the first mover advantage. Do you think it'll be a long way before we see more and more disruptions and innovations coming in? Have we in many ways settled in this phase now? Or do you think that we're still, this is just the tip of the iceberg and there's plenty more to come right now?
So the way I look at the opportunities for creation of large, valuable companies by entrepreneurs in our sort of broad technology space is whether they're solving a real need which is large enough or not.
Okay.
Right. So as long as entrepreneurs keep finding real needs that are large enough to solve, we'll keep seeing big companies getting created,
right,
which is exactly what is happening in more developed markets. The other trend or the tailwind is the widespread internet adoption over the mobile.
Right.
The deeper the internet adoption over mobile in India is going to be, the more larger companies you'll see get created, which will ride that wave.
Sure.
Right. For the longest time, I remember if I had to go to the airport at 6 a.m., I would have to first get into the car at 5:30 a.m. With a family member, go search for a taxi near the taxi stand. Right. No longer. Now
right.
I just press a button.
Exactly.
Right. So that's a real need, which is a significant enough need for millions of people. Same applies to shopping. Same applies. We started doing loans, micro loans to consumers and micro loans to small businesses through our platform.
Sure.
Very successfully. For a small business owner to go get a loan which was not backed by collateral for working capital needs for a 2-week period without paying 3% interest per month was pretty challenging.
Okay.
Now we can get it done in two hours. Right, so
is there anything which is far-fetched for the online entrepreneurs? I'm sorry to interrupt you there, because in the beginning we heard Rajat Vahi say that fruits and vegetables for a rural customer too far-fetched. Do you think like that?
I think everything is possible. It's only about you have to prioritize and you have to go after the needs which are here and now and addressable for millions of people rather than going for corner cases today.
Right.
So it's very important to solve real needs for lots of people.
So you're saying that the trick really remains that as long as it's a real need you're addressing and it's serving a huge market, then you're on the right path as far as making sure that you have that disruptive or innovative model. I'd like to quickly touch upon the rural market and the internet penetration piece. Perhaps Mr. Vahi, you could mention that or any of you in terms of the way we're seeing even the financial market penetrate into rural areas. Many people earlier did question whether we're going to see internet penetration much deeper. Of course, the entire debate around net neutrality has also been, the heart of the debate has been that markets like India need much more internet penetration and it's very different from a developed market. Now, are we now moving to a situation where the growth in the tier two cities is way more than what we are seeing in the tier one cities, and that will be the real driving force for the kind of growth we'll see in this industry?
My sense is that, yeah, I mean, in many categories, you're already seeing 30, 40, 50% of the purchases, online purchases being done by tier two, tier three, or what we call urban space.
Right.
So clearly some categories that's going to see a lot more. Again, it also depends on where the footprint of retail is. If today it's available around the corner from your house, it's easily available next door, would you be willing to go and use the online to do that? Maybe not. But if you look at tier two, tier three cities, the footprint of retailers is very, very poor, weak, has not developed a lot. There are hardly that many outlets people can get to, and the whole assortment is not there. So of course people are going to switch to that. So I think it will happen. It's clearly going to be a big driver. And I think what the other point is going to be about credit card penetration,
sure,
ability to be able to pay online, all of that. And I think Kunal wants to talk about
that.
One of the top selling products in the smaller towns of India on our platform is a blood sugar monitor.
Wow. Okay.
And followed closely by a blood pressure monitor.
Okay, interesting.
Because, one out of three Indians are diabetic or some ratio like that. And there aren't enough clinics where acutely diabetic people can go and get their blood sugar tested every single day, or which are cost effective enough, right? Here, you can just test your blood sugar every day. And you'll be surprised, so many clinics and these pharmacies in small parts of the country don't carry these devices. So you're really solving a real need, which is materially life-changing for someone.
Sure. Kunal, a quick word. I'll just come to you because you've actually pointed to a trend which comes as a surprise, that it's not perhaps apparel or things that you would traditionally assume is something being bought online, but a real need, as you mentioned, blood sugar monitors, BP monitors that are selling like hotcakes, and in some of those tier two cities. Have you yourself been taken a little by surprise with the kind and the manner of explosion you've seen in the online market? Has it surprised you today when you look back? Did you expect this kind of growth?
No, nowhere close. And I don't think even today we can expect what will happen 3 years out, despite having seen what we've seen over the last 3 years. And I think that's a good thing. We got to keep feeling surprised. Only then will we keep feeling excited about doing what we're doing.
As a young, successful entrepreneur, billionaire, what's a message you'd have to all those young entrepreneurs who are perhaps looking at creating the next Snap deal?
I think of your adjectives, only young was correct, maybe. But neither successful nor
billionaire. Okay.
I think jury is very much out on our industry. Jury is very much out on our company, as it should be till the time we have conclusively, done something. But I think it's just primarily just focusing on solving a real need which impacts lives of millions of people. And I think in any country, I don't think we need more government policy, more government intervention necessarily in everything. What we need is more entrepreneurs who
right.
are solving these real needs.
Right. Mr. Singhal, you were making a point. Sorry, go ahead. No, please go back to where we were.
I was only talking in the context of rural or small town India.
Yes.
So while at this moment there is, let's say, lack of availability of the glucometers and various others, but finally, consumption corresponds to the purchasing power, and we will see within 3 to 5 years' time the size of the markets or the opportunity reflecting exactly what the purchasing power is. So let's not get too carried away by the person in Leh who has bought something and whatever somebody else may have bought in Agartala. It's nice to talk about, but in reality, the Delhis and the Mumbais and the Bangalores and the Madrases and others, which are creating wealth in the hands of consumers, they will remain to be the largest opportunity markets for the country for the number of years to come.
Okay, no, I'd like to elaborate on the point you're making. So the point that came from Kunal, of course, was the fact that sometimes what surprises you is the kind of products that are being bought and the kind of markets that are looking at, because you simply don't have that availability.
No, I fully agree with you there.
Right.
And with Kunal, that right now it's an availability is the single biggest driver in small town India. And therefore, the numbers, whether they're 10,000 glucometers or 5,000 or 20,000.
But would it not continue to be the advantage, coming back to our original question?
It will not necessarily continue, because if people don't have money beyond a certain point there, it will correspond to the purchasing power of the people in various parts. If the rural incomes do not go up, consumption will remain... That's the only point I'm missing.
That, of course. But I'm saying that, again, if we come back to the original theme of the debate, which is traditional store-based format versus online, the fact that you may not have the availability in a traditional, conventional retail format of those products that he's selling online on his platform gives it that inherent advantage of that customer sitting
Absolutely.
In a far-out place.
Absolutely. So e-commerce is fulfilling a real need, like Kunal said. And that is why I'm very excited personally about the potential of this sector. I was only making the limited point that if you were to do like Kunal's next $50 billion of turnovers, will it come from 600,000 villages and 5,500 towns? I would still think that maybe the Pareto rule will apply there as well, that 80% of his business might come from just 10 cities in India, 20 cities.
Kunal, agree, disagree?
So I can't disagree with statistics, right? The overall spending of the top few cities is very, very high. But I'll give you statistics. 12% of our sales comes from the Northeast now.
12%. Okay.
And it's incredible.
Right.
Where if you know the terrain in the Northeast, it's incredibly hard to even reach there for anyone. When the JNK floods happened, we saw a surge in buying in Jammu and Kashmir from our platform.
Right.
And we made sure that all the logistics companies were absolutely serving those markets, and we actually paid them more to serve those markets, because that's when we knew people needed us the most.
Right. So going back to your original point of the need and the number of people, which would really be the driving force. We've had a very, very interesting and exciting discussion here. I'm going to throw it open to actually the audience, and if there are any questions, I can see plenty of hands being raised. My request, please, Mr. Bahi, go ahead.
Just going back to the original point about the coexistence, and I think what you may see evolve is the whole piece around click and collect, because what you're seeing in Europe and many of the parts is that where you'll be able to order a product and buy it from the retail outlet, where retail outlets will become virtual stores where you can go and scan. And many retailers are trying that across Europe, where you've got virtual stores where you can go into a store, look at the product, order it online in the store. So you can have different hybrid models. So I think that to the original point, that
Sure.
click and mortar will exist, but it'll adapt. It'll adapt as we go along, and it'll form some form of this whole piece around, you know, link to e-commerce.
Fair enough. Yeah, we'll invite. Yeah. Just one moment before we take the questions. My request would be to please keep the question brief and let it be not a comment but a very pointed question. Go ahead, sir.
Well, Mr. Vahi has to some extent preempted it, but to Kunal, you know, there are people going to Barnes and Nobles and clicking online to order a book after having felt it. The field touch requirement, or Best Buy or other places, is now increasing number. So do you think the ultimate format would neither be e-click nor bricks, but a hybrid format? Is e-commerce companies evolving in that direction rather than the other way around?
Actually, it's an excellent point. This is what we call omni-channel, right? Where the lines, when we first started the discussion, the lines between online and offline are blurring very, very quickly. So we would love to offer our consumers the opportunity, and our merchants who are selling on our platform, the opportunity to say, here is my product, but if you want it, you can pay online, but come collect it offline. So we believe that that's going to be a huge trend even in India, because this offline retail footprint that has gotten built over the last few decades is not going to go up in smoke overnight. We have to figure out how can we drive online demand generation towards offline fulfillment. Because a lot of consumers, even in the best case scenario, South Korea has the highest e-commerce penetration in the world. And as a percentage of retail, it is still only 14%. So 86% of retail is still happening offline. And I don't think the trend will be very different in India. In steady state, maybe 20% or 25% of demand generation will be online in India. But a lot of that fulfillment will need to be offline.
Okay, I'd like to just quickly add to that very, very important question that has been asked. When he asked about the touch feel aspect of it, do you think it's still again a question that gets asked by investors? For instance, you were saying earlier the question of whether internet penetration will happen in India or not was some of the questions being asked. Logistics was a question that was being asked. Does the touch feel aspect of it is still a question being asked in markets like India and globally? Or do you think it's irrelevant now, and the growth of e-commerce has actually answered the question that it's not relevant to physically see a product?
See, you can't be everything to everyone, right? Okay. You have to be most things to many people. But you can't be everything to everyone, because you can't say all people who are buying apparel today in the country will suddenly start buying online. It's not going to happen.
Sure.
There will be some people who will say, maybe 10% or 20% of them who will say, hey, I'm willing to buy online. Try it out. If I don't like it, I'll send it back, right? But I'm willing to give it a shot. Earlier, I have to be honest, I never thought my mom, who never used a PC before, she would start using a smartphone and start ordering on Snapdeal every day to my father's misery. But
not to your misery.
Yeah, as long as she's buying from us. But you know, it's about building confidence. She ordered one bed sheet. She liked it. Then she now orders one every 2 weeks.
Sure.
So I think it's about building that trust, and sometimes it gets built and sometimes it does not. And many consumers, I've also heard, they buy something online, they say, no, I prefer buying offline only.
Sure.
There'll be all kinds of consumers in the world. We have to make sure we can carve out a section for whom we can solve a need.
And that's why it's important for you to acquire that customer base and perhaps the pricing discounts and other things that happen. Go ahead, sir, ask the question. Okay, there's someone who already has a mic. Go ahead.
Yeah, I actually... We ran one of the biggest internet company in India. I was a part of that company and the mobile company. And I would like to mention that ignoring the rural market, which I learned from the panelists, may be a very big mistake to do, because we found that when the mobile telephones were launched in the semi-urban and rural areas, everybody ridiculed us. But then the demand was so much that we were swept off the feet. So I would like to know from you, what are your serious plans about rural marketing on the e-commerce? Because what I find is the kind of effort you carry out in the urban centers when you sell the mobile phones and so on is not present in the rural area. So do you have a serious plan? That is question number one. The question number two, which is very quick, the net neutrality debate, I am watching it from a distance, and I find it is more of a creation of the corporate, rivalry and struggle rather than a real debate.
Is that a question to Kunal or any of the panelists?
To the panelists, because I find that the individual has a right to click or not to click. It will all depend on the product.
No, both questions can be addressed by anybody?
Anybody. Yeah,
Okay. Anybody would like to take it quickly? On the rural market, perhaps? Yeah.
So I think on the my view on the rural is that, you know, it's going to be a big part of, and I'm not just talking about rural, I'm talking about tier 2, tier 3, so what we call urban India. I think that is going to be a big part of the consumption, the consumers that e-commerce will serve. They already are in some I think what some of the data we are seeing in some e-commerce players, 30, 40, up to 50% of the business is now coming from outside of tier one cities. So yeah, for some categories of products, again, it's back to what Arvind was saying, it depends on the price point. If the price point is lower for certain products, you're going to get a much broader base consumption. If the price point is higher, you're going to see it from the areas where people can afford that. So again, you know, whether it's going to be all urban or rural, I think that from e-commerce companies, I don't think they differentiate whether you buy from urban or rural, right? So,
okay, net neutrality being more a corporate, Kunal? Okay, last question, we're really out of time.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Kunal, I have a very specific question for you. You mentioned about the success of your platform in Northeast India, and I come from small town Northeast India, and I've seen how your company has gotten ahead of competition in that part of the country. And I just want to know from you very, very quickly, what in your opinion have you done right to achieve that?
Thank you. I'm glad you supported one of my claims. to Mr. Y's point earlier, you know, 70% of our sales are coming out from beyond the top 10 cities of India now. And that number was 30% a year ago. And 90% of all the transactions in these tier 2 markets are over mobile now. Right? A few things we did right. One, we made sure that if you had to use our platform on the mobile. It was very easy to use, and it didn't require you to have a very good quality data connection. Secondly, we worked very closely with logistics companies to make sure that we tell them, here is where demand is coming, but we are turning it away because we can tell where people are staying or where they want to order the product to reach, but currently no logistics company is servicing that area. So it's been a multi-year effort to drive that, and it's not easy to do it. But that's how you build enterprise value in this business.
All right, I'm really sorry. I know there are plenty of people who've got their hands raised and wanted to ask questions, but we are out of time and we have the next session. I'd like to thank all the panelists for sharing their insights. It's been a fascinating discussion, a very, very exciting one, addressing really a trend that is in many ways transforming India, transforming the world. The basic consensus that seems to emerge is that yes, online and offline will continue to coexist, but the lines are blurring. They're not necessarily competing with one another. They may actually complement one another and even partner with one another to take forward the overall experience, to actually take forward the overall retail pie, which seems to be growing. As long as the larger need of people and a large number of people is being addressed, as Kunal heard, we will see many, many more successful young entrepreneurs, some turning into billionaires as well. That will continue to happen, and we'll continue to see overall, the retail experience, or the overall buying experience getting transformed for consumers like you and me, which is really going to be a driving trend going forward. Thanks so much for being a very, very patient audience, and thank you all for sharing your thoughts and insights.
Rich and fascinating discussion. Thank you to all our panelists. I'd like to request Mr. Chandan Chaudhary, Managing Director, Dassault Systems India Private Limited, to please present mementos to all our respected panelists. Lot of brilliant takeaways from that session. And of course, going forward, we will be taking this discussion up a notch. We'll be talking about e-governance. And for this session, a special thank you to Mr. Sunil Kaushal, CEO of Standard Chartered Bank. Of course, Standard Chartered has been our partner in putting the Mind Mind Summit together.